And I welcome Afzal Siddiqui, who is a professor at the Department of Computer and System Sciences at Stockholm University.
So yes, thank you for having me here. As you mentioned, I'm a professor at Stockholm University. I'm part of the String project that's jointly implemented with the Chalmers University of Technology. In this work, we're going to explore the interactions among storage, transmission, and renewable generation in the Nordic power sector. And the motivation for this work stems from the fact that the Nordic countries want to decarbonize their power sectors over the next 20 years. What this will mean in practice is that a lot of the power generation will come from variable renewable energy, such as wind and solar power. These technologies, as you know, have the advantage that they are carbon free, but the disadvantage is that their output is intermittent, which necessitates flexibility on the supply side, as we've been hearing earlier today. Now, the Nordic countries are fortunate because they have large hydro reservoirs, especially in Norway and Sweden, and they can function effectively as large batteries to store the excess power from wind, let's say during periods of low demand, and then to release the water during periods of low wind output in order to keep the system in balance. Now, this is a somewhat optimistic perspective of the situation because it ignores the reality that the power sector is deregulated, not only in the Nordic region, but around the world. So this means that the flexible assets are often owned by profit-maximizing power companies that may have different objectives than maximizing welfare, which is the social objective. And indeed, some of these companies have high enough market shares that when they can move energy or water around in order to shift the prices between periods or between locations in order to maximize their profit. And this kind of distortion is known as market power. So we will try to study the implications of these changes to the power system by developing game theoretic models that will incorporate the physical realism from the engineering side, as well as a representation of strategic behavior from the economic side. And we will try to address the following sets of questions. First of all, in the future, as we have more and more VRE in the power system, what are going to be the implications on prices, on welfare, on emissions, even if all the power companies behave perfectly competitively? Next, we will allow for this kind of strategic behavior to assess the additional impact of market power in such a future power system. So we will try to quantify both the technical requirements as well as the market necessitated changes to the power sector in the near future. After having quantified these kinds of distortions, let's say, we will then, in the second part of the project, add an upper level to the model as depicted in the bottom right-hand panel, where the upper level will represent the perspective of a regulated entity such as the Environmental Protection Agency or the transmission system operator that can undertake countervailing actions in order to mitigate the extent of the distortions from the lower level. So such an entity will be able to anticipate that power companies may behave strategically and could then undertake regulation such as revised emissions targets or revised water regulation or invest in new transmission lines in order to alleviate the extent of the distortions. So the project has just started, so we don't have actual results yet. We're still in the early phases of model development, but I do have some results from previous projects that could perhaps inform our work going forward. One of them has to do with device efficiency and carbon policy. So again, storage is going to underpin this sustainable energy transition in the Nordic countries and elsewhere, and it would be desirable for storage devices to become more and more efficient. That will help to improve welfare and reduce emissions. However, a storage owner may not always want to have higher device efficiency because we have seen from previous work that storage owners that have market power would actually be able to use the storage device as a tool to move energy from the peak period to the off-peak period. So they would actually be able to raise the price more in the peak period by more than it lowers the price in the off-peak period. So the spread is then going to be the temporal arbitrage that they exert in the market, and that boosts their profit at the expense of social welfare. So that's perhaps not that surprising, but we found that this kind of distortion could arise even under perfect competition, where the storage owner does not necessarily have that leverage. And we can try to see how it's affected through the device efficiency's impact on the marginal value of storage. So the marginal value of storage is how much extra the storage owner would be willing to pay for an extra unit of capacity of storage. And we've plotted this here in the lower left panel with respect to F. So F is a parameter that's the inverse of the device efficiency. So if F is equal to 2, it's a 50% efficient device. If F is equal to 1, it's a 100% efficient device. So you read this chart actually going from the right to the left if you want to examine the impact of increasing device efficiency. This dashed curve indicates the marginal value of storage. You can see that as the device efficiency increases, it's increasing, but then it reaches a turning point, and after that, it actually starts to decrease. So what's happening is that the device, after a certain point, becomes so efficient that there's actually too much energy in the peak period, which then starts to lower the price in the peak period and eat into the device owner's profit. So what it does is it starts to behave kind of like a strategic owner. It starts to dump the energy in the off-peak period, which is not desirable for society. So how can we try to align the incentive of the private storage owner with the public, which is social welfare? Well, we found that if you have a high enough carbon tax on thermal generation, that will create a scarcity for this kind of service. And then that marginal value is plotted in the red curve. So that is with the carbon tax. You can see that the marginal value of storage is higher, and it's also increasing for a wider range of the efficiency. So then the storage owner would be going along with the social desire to improve efficiency. And last thing that I want to say is that the network topology also affects how regulation may be implemented. And this is a result from a case study that we did for the New York-Quebec interconnection, which shares some similarities with the Nordic region because Quebec has a lot of hydro reservoirs. New York has a lot of variable renewable energy. So in an ideal world, the reservoirs in Quebec could be used to balance out the intermittencies from the production in New York. And indeed, that's what we observe if we allow the Quebec producer to behave perfectly competitively. But if it's allowed to behave strategically, then what it does is it takes the water during the peak seasons and it shifts it to the off-peak seasons, again, to boost the price more in the peak season than it depresses the price in the off-peak season. And you can see that the lower left-hand panel where the blue bars are the hydro production under perfect competition. The orange bars are those under strategic behavior. You can see that in the peak winter and fall seasons, it's reducing the amount of water used and it's increasing the amount of water used during the spring season. And this kind of behavior can be mitigated by regulating the net hydro usage and the net imports. So you try to prevent this producer from getting rid of the excess water during the off-peak season. But then what this might do is create an opportunity for spatial arbitrage, that is changing the price differences between locations by firms in New York that have thermal plants at one location and pumped hydro storage at another. And the New York Power Authority has a thermal plant in New York City in the southern part of the state. It has pumped hydro in the northern part of the state. And what we observe that if you take the Quebec producer, if you reduce the Quebec producer's influence, then this gives it the opportunity to produce more from the thermal plant in New York to increase its exports, increase the selling price, then to increase the imports in the northern part of New York to depress the buying price. So it increases the price at which it sells electricity, reduces the price at which it buys electricity, and then that extra energy, it just cycles through its pumped hydro storage and basically destroys that energy, which is a big distortion to society. But you can see that in some cases, you can have one kind of regulation that's effective at mitigating temporal arbitrage, but then it might create a distortion elsewhere.
Thank you.
These are the kinds of results we're looking out for.
Thank you so much. We will have to break here for a couple of questions. I don't know if you were watching the sessions before lunch, but this is really interesting because in the decadent action session, we were actually talking a lot about the need to do research on market models and regulations now. So I was kind of wondering, in that context, are you going to look at future possible market regulations and changes to the market construction as well, or are you just going to look at the way the market functions today in Sweden?
Well, this is a very important point. This is why we are trying to engage with stakeholders such as the Svenska Kraftnät and the Environmental Protection Agency in order to figure out what kinds of candidate regulations or transmission investment plans they have in mind. We can take those and embed them in our modeling framework and try to assess the implications of those when they interact with the potential for strategic behavior.
Yeah, interesting. I think I will ask you, Carolina, what value do you see? How does this project complement the Samspel portfolio? It's a bit different from... Yes. From a lot of other projects.
Yes, it is. But we see that this project can fill the knowledge gap regarding how the market power and the interaction between different actors on the electricity market is affected of a system with 100% renewable energy production into it. And it's one of Sunspel's long-term goals to also look at these questions. But I have a question to the project. Afzal, do you have any early results or insights to share with us already?
At this moment, no. We are still in the early phases of model development. We have most of the data that we need. But one thing that's interesting is that data on the Norwegian hydro reservoirs are relatively easy to obtain. But for some reason, the ones for the Swedish hydro reservoirs are much more difficult to obtain. So we are trying to do our best in order to calibrate our model so it's able to kind of replicate the market situation as it is now. Once we're confident with that, then we can proceed to the next step.
Okay, I think we might have time for one more short question. I was thinking about the differences between, because your previous research was done in the US, as I understand, and between US and Canada. What are the largest differences? Like on the market regulation level, do they have a completely different market system or is it similar to the one that we have?
Well, there are some similarities in the sense that New York is part of a pool. It, just like Nord Pool is kind of an integrated electricity market. You can buy and produce electricity all over the Nordic region at the prevailing price. Quebec is a little bit different because there's only one large producer. It's the provincial monopoly, Hydro-Québec. So it's under a lot of regulation. But in practice, it's maybe not that different because hydro production in the Nordic regions would also be under some kind of regulation because the water usage has impacts on other stakeholders, such as environmental stakeholders, farming and fisheries and so on. So I think what our framework allows us to do is that it's flexible enough to be able to examine different kinds of configurations. So no matter where you are right now, whether it's North America or Europe, you can look at different proposals and then try to assess their advantages and disadvantages.
All right, we are going to get a little bit of a summary of this day, but while they are getting ready, I'm just going to look if we have some short questions from the audience. No, I don't think so. So perhaps one more question that I could ask while we wait is, this is kind of an interdisciplinary project, which has both a technical and economical component. What would you say are the biggest challenges and perhaps opportunities as well, working in that kind of project?
Yeah, so I think the challenge is trying to come up with the appropriate framework to address the kinds of questions that we ask. We are somewhere in the middle. We're trying to take a perspective on markets and institutions that is incorporating the physical realism from the engineering side. So that's, I think, both a challenge, because it's which kinds of questions do you want to go more into depth with, and that will inform your modeling framework. But at the same time, I think it's an advantage, because a lot of economics models, they don't really have this physical realism. And on the other side, a lot of engineering models, they do very well to go into the technical details, but then they're kind of agnostic about the institutions and the market behavior and so on. So we're trying to straddle both worlds. And I think it'll be an iterative process in terms of determining how the questions feed back into the modeling framework and vice versa.
Thank you. I also personally think it's very important to have that kind of research to bridge this gap as well, to take the technical research beyond academia and out into industry. So thank you very much.
Thank you.